introduction. I'm delighted to be here. Is this mic working all right? Okay. I am particularly happy to be here because I presented an early, very, very early version of this many years ago, but also because I've been inspired by the work of many people here, Leora primarily, Hanok's work on private law, and a whole range of other people. So I'm very excited to present what is very much, I must say, a work in progress. Because what I'm trying to do is to take a phenomenon that I observe, and that is the fact that our idea and our approach to past wrongs has changed very dramatically in the past couple of decades. And although a lot of people do deep dives into particular areas, I'm sort of trying to understand what is going on with this phenomenon in a way as a whole, and if we understand something about how it arises and what its sources are, then we may perhaps do a little bit better in terms of how to respond. So let me begin with that. I think we can all agree that individual suffering has always persisted, that when people get badly injured by the wrongs of others, they don't immediately heal. But law and politics have not taken that as their point of view. Typically, until very recently, I think that the overall view, both in law and in politics, could be encapsulated as the idea that time heals all wounds. And the political sphere proved to be quite deaf to the claims of people who tried to bring forward old grievances, and law enforced very strict time bars against people who tried to bring forward old injustices, no matter how terrible those injustices were. That has changed very dramatically, however, in the past couple of decades. I won't give you a whole list of things, but here are just a few examples that are very recent about how institutions, both public and private, are being forced to face their past, sometimes very distant past, in a way that they never have before, sometimes asked to return things that they've held on to for centuries. So, for example, just this November, only a few weeks ago, the descendant of a slave sued Harvard University for photographs of her ancestors that were taken in the 1850s. The Catholic Church, over the past couple of decades, has paid up billions of dollars around the world, and practically every day faces new revelations and new claims for damages arising out of historic sexual abuse, and there's even talk of a Catholic Truth Commission. Japan just apologized to and compensated women it sterilized against their will decades ago. A museum in Manchester a couple of weeks ago returned hundreds of objects, including human remains, to Australia over 100 years after they were taken. A Korean court awarded compensation for wartime slave labor. Georgetown University announced it would give preferential admissions treatment to the descendants of slaves that it sold in a sale in 1850. Canada agreed to pay billions of dollars to Indigenous children that were abused in schools decades ago. The consortium universities studying slavery now has well over 50 members, and Japan just apologized again and offered more compensation to the women euphemistically known as comfort women. Those are just a few examples. I could go on, but I don't want to take up all my time listing examples. Instead, I'm going to try to share with you a little bit about how I understand that. I kind of have two aims here. Partly, it's genealogical. I'm interested in how this happened. So how did this come to be? But my interest is not purely genealogical. I believe, as I said, that perhaps if we have greater insight into the things that drove what has sometimes been called the memory industry, the restitution revolution, there are all sorts of terms for this, most of them disparaging, so I don't necessarily share that view. But my sense is that if we understand it a little bit more, as I said, we might be better at figuring out how to respond. Law, as Leora's comments suggested, law is an important part of this picture, law and legal principles. It's an important driver, but its role is also very complex. legal principles figure, I will argue, both in the foreground and in the background of cases like these, but they do so in a distinct way that both affects their power and I think gives us some insight into how we ought to respond to these issues. So a little bit of genealogy, what happened. I'm going to begin with the Holocaust, but I'm not going to say very much about it because I'm just going to take for granted that there's a general understanding of some of the aftermath of the Holocaust. That is a point of departure for talking about how some of these other examples use the Holocaust model as both model and inspiration for their own efforts to redress historic wrongs. One of the legacies of Nuremberg, I argue elsewhere, as many other people do, is to reconceptualize atrocity as a matter of injustice. Nuremberg itself and the trials are the most obvious examples, but there are many others that are equally important. The restitution courts, Holocaust reparations litigation of the 90s that Leora has written about so beautifully, and the ongoing efforts to get restitution of looted art. The reconceptualization of mass violence as injustice, I argue, changed the conversation about the past. And what it did was it enabled others who had long held sorrows and grievances about their treatment to imagine that it might be possible to demand justice for old wrongs. In the process, some of the issues and some of the challenges of transitional justice started to come home to non-transitional legal orders, to stable legal regimes. So just very, very quickly, the 80s and 90s, as I think people know, were a period of enormous change, and again, I'm very indebted to Leora's wonderful work on this. As the Berlin Wall fell and the Cold War ended, it started to become possible to imagine some renewal of the efforts that had early taken place in the aftermath of the Holocaust to get some both material reparations and compensation for grievous harm. Leora, again, has written about this in a very significant and important way. So developments like the Swiss banks litigation, the Holocaust victims litigation, and the Washington principles, I think, started to inspire others. The civil rights movement in the United States and elsewhere started to become very frustrated with criminal law, with constitutional law, and with other things, and it started to look to the private law actions in much the same way as the Holocaust litigation did. And so inspired by the dramatic uses of private law in the Holocaust litigation, other survivors of old injustice started to reach for private law. They started to claim the damages for terrible old injustices like slavery, like eugenics, like institutional violence. And of course, the barriers that they faced when they did so were formidable. Limitations periods, of course, immunities, restrictive liability rules. One of the things that I started to notice when I tried to understand how did the door to private law open up to the extent that it has, is that it opened, I think, in a rather unusual way. In the 1980s, children who had been victims of Catholic Church sex abuse started to think about suing the Catholic Church. It began with some media cases, and a few courageous individuals started to push very, very hard to get damages. And they met, of course, formidable obstacles, statutes of limitations. Most survivors of sexual abuse do not sue until decades later. Institutional immunities, the church had charitable immunity, and the Vatican actually has sovereign immunity as well as narrow liability rules. But because those cases involved such horrific abuse of children by those entrusted with their care, the plaintiffs, I argue, also presented an especially compelling case for the duty to repair. So this very compelling underlying principle that really animates a lot of private law responsibility, I call it reparative justice, there are lots of other terms for it. And so as more and more cases involving the terrible abuse of vulnerable children and also of institutional complicity started to come to light, courts actually began to wonder about whether it was right to apply limitations periods in some of these cases, whether or not they should allow the church to protect itself with claims of charitable immunity. And legislators also started to act across the globe to create discrete exceptions for childhood sexual abuse and to refuse to apply things like sovereign immunity, charitable immunity, etc. And they also did something else that was really important. They started to change liability rules. So they started to make it much easier to actually pass on liability of a criminal act to an institution. It used to be very, very hard. And so in that way, that's one of the important drivers, I argue, for why the private law started to open up in this way, and it started to become possible for others to think about pursuing much bolder and more dramatic claims even than the childhood sexual abuse claims. Let me give you, there are many examples, but let me give you a Canadian example. In Canada, the Holocaust litigation and the Catholic Church sex abuse litigation was watched by tens of thousands of people who were Indigenous, who had been taken forcibly from their families and placed in schools run by the federal government and by the churches. And in those schools, they had been punished for speaking their language, for practicing their spirituality, often horrific physical and sexual abuse. But for decades, no one really spoke about this. Of course, this is a common theme with survivors. But they watched the Catholic Church litigation and the Holocaust litigation, and they started to think that maybe it was possible to do something. And so beginning in the mid-1990s, they started to bring actions to court. Those actions were incredibly interesting. They combined the kind of action, ordinary private law action for assault and battery, things pretty well known to private law, but they combined them with other kinds of claims, claims for loss of language, loss of family, loss of spirituality, damage to culture. And by the time that the federal government finally had to settle these actions, there were hundreds of thousands of claims. And there was a $6 billion settlement by the federal government of Canada. It created a Truth and Reconciliation Commission that just reported a few years ago, just finished reporting. There was an apology by the federal government. There was a very complex adjudication system that I've been involved in overseeing that gave compensation for physical and sexual abuse suffered in those schools. So that Indian residential schools case is a good example, I think, of the hybridity that started to emerge, and I think Leora again has written about this hybridity, that you have the private law form of action that enables individuals who've never been able to be heard to insist on at least a hearing, if not success, before a court. But often those private law actions are infused with other things. In the case of the Indigenous children, it was constitutional norms of equality, international norms against torture, the rights of Indigenous people. And they often ask for remedies that look more like transitional justice. They're an apology, they're a truth commission, they're the creation of an archive. Those are equally, if not more important to the survivors than the actual compensation. Although because the compensation is so symbolic, that's also very critical as well, the way it unfolds. There are a number of other examples. I won't go through them in too much detail. English examples where courts started to, in one case, gave survivors compensation for the Mau Mau uprising and apologized, created a memorial, etc. Again, things that would have been very, very hard to imagine only a few decades before. And I'm sure the English government in that case, as with the Canadian government, was kind of shocked to find itself actually facing this kind of litigation. Those cases are examples of what I call kind of the private law principles. In that case, reparative justice in the foreground. there are lots of cases as well where the principal is in the background. So it performs an important function in putting pressure on institutions, whether it's governments, museums, universities, but it's not necessarily litigation. Let me give you maybe one example of that, eugenics. So eugenics is another example, happened around the world for many, many decades. Individuals who suffered at the hands of governments have tried, have wanted to get compensation, but their claims fell in general on deaf ears. And there have been a few cases where they have made efforts to get compensation, but they failed. However, as some of this other, the Holocaust litigation, some of this other institutional abuse litigation got going, you also started to see in the early 2000s governments beginning to apologize for eugenics. Then one or two governments started to give some compensation for eugenics. And just a couple of examples, again, recently, North Carolina was the first state to actually give compensation to people that it had wrongly sterilized. Virginia followed suit, and right now there's a bill before the California legislature that proposes giving compensation to people it sterilized decades ago, and also acknowledging the state's role in wrongly sterilizing people. So beginning with the Holocaust and sort of inspired by a lot of those efforts, and I'm just giving you a few examples so I don't overwhelm, but I'm happy to talk about more of these. You can see these knock-on effects around the world. Japan as well, as I said, just recently compensated and apologized to people that it had sterilized decades ago. There's a similar process undergoing that we see undergoing in the law of restitution. So what I've been talking about so far is responsibility claims, so claims for harm to the person, but paralleling this and often occurring in the same fact situation, of course, you have claims not only to harm to the person, horrible harm to the person, but also the destruction of culture and of material culture in particular. And with the rise of restitution, as with the rise of reparations, you also see kind of the difficulty of taking these powerful principles and confining them to one fact situation. So in the case of restitution, again, the Holocaust and the aftermath of the Holocaust and the development of the Washington principles was incredibly powerful. But what we have seen is that because, I think, of the moral power of that principle, it has proved very, very difficult to make the argument that the only situation that that applied to was the Holocaust. And so increasingly around the world, what you see is individuals and cultures that have suffered loss saying, why shouldn't something like that apply to us as well? I'll give you just a couple of examples. Perhaps the most dramatic one, and the one probably that people know about, is the recent publication of the Macron report in France. This was, I think, was kind of presaged in 1994 when Chancellor Helmut Kohl gave back to France some 27 French paintings that had been stolen by the Nazis. Mitterrand thanked him, but he also betrayed a little bit of anxiety. He said, even though it was a great day, museum curators must be rather uneasy because they must understand that it could be rather difficult to confine the example of restitution only to those cases. He actually referred to it as a contagion, which I found rather interesting. And of course, that has only heightened in recent years with the publication of the Macron report. As you're probably aware, that report makes a powerful claim for the moral right of restitution, and says that basically argues in favor of return back to Africa for colonial era works unless it could be proved they were acquired legitimately. So the reverse onus in that case is kind of interesting, and it's actually being picked up elsewhere, including in North America for goods related to indigenous peoples. Now, while the Macron report on its surface only affected France, of course, it addressed European colonialism and the material legacy of European colonialism. And now, as you, again, as you may know, museums, individuals, collections in Europe and elsewhere are under pressure to return hundreds of thousands of artifacts that they collected during the colonial era. Again, I won't go through all of the examples, but if you're following the Humboldt Forum, you might know that there's been a lot of activity there. The Rijksmuseum has just opened talks on the restitution of colonial era loot to Indonesia and Sri Lanka. Its director said, we should have done it earlier and we have no excuse. Similarly, the Netherlands Museum of World Cultures has pledged proactively to return a whole large collection of artifacts stolen during the colonial era. You probably know that the British Museum hasn't been quite as active in this regard. It does have the single largest collection of African artifacts in Europe, and it is under fire for having what is referred to as its head in the sand on these issues. Recently, the Egyptian-British novelist Adav Souif, who's a wonderful novelist, publicly resigned from the board of the British Museum and pointed, among other things, to their refusal to be more active on provenance as one of her reasons. She said, the British Museum, born and bred in empire and colonial practice, is coming under scrutiny, and yet it hardly speaks. There are other developments, however, and I know we'll be talking about some of these in the next couple of days. The European Parliament is considering legislation that has much in common with the Washington Principles, and it refers specifically to goods collected during colonization. And the Open Society Foundation, thank you for pointing me to this, Alex, just pledged $15 million over 4 years for the restitution of African heritage. In settler societies, like my own in Canada, there have also been major efforts to begin to respond to Indigenous peoples' concerns about both the loss of their ancestors, the taking of human remains, but also the loss of their material culture. Just one example, the Haida Repatriation Committee in British Columbia was actually formed in 1999, and they brought home over 500 ancestors from the world's museums, although the British Museum still hasn't given theirs up. but they've also been very active in the return of precious cultural property, and it's a sign, I think, of how much the conversation around this has changed, that the CEO of the Royal Museum of British Columbia, which has a huge collection of Indigenous material, has referred to the moral obligation to support Indigenous repatriation and has announced that it will return any precious items collected during the government ban on potlatches, which was actually when the federal government collected a lot of antiquities. So let me try to give a few lessons that I might take from some of this little bit of a tour of all of these activities. As I've mentioned, I think you can identify two different ways that private law plays a role in these cases. The new ability on behalf of survivors to use private law enables them to be heard as never before. So even if they fail, the mere fact of being able to make a claim heard for many survivors is incredibly powerful. And often they prompt a response from institutions that have been unresponsive, literally, for decades or sometimes even centuries. I point to the case involving the Harvard photograph. That has been the object of efforts to get those photographs back. I don't know if you've seen them. I feel complicated looking at them, actually, because they were, I wonder if the articles about them should show them or not, but we can discuss that. But often, as I said, the new use of private law makes these things possible. In Canada's case, we would not have had a truth commission. We would not have the awareness I think we have nationally of our treatment of Indigenous peoples and many other things if survivors had not been able to make use of private law actions. Often, though, private law serves a more background role. Even interestingly, where legal cases fail, There has been litigation in the U.S. involving reparations for slavery and really very, very little movement on those cases. But it's interesting that even in the aftermath of that litigation, there's been a huge amount of activity on the legacy of slavery. As I mentioned, over 50 universities now have study groups on slavery. The activities of those study groups often unearth issues and things that require and sometimes demand other sorts of activities. The Georgetown preferential admissions decision is an interesting example. Jesus College in Cambridge just apologized for slavery and handed back some bronzes to Benin. So those study groups, although the litigation failed, interestingly, the study groups spur a whole range of other activities. They also create archives, which is one of the main things that survivors want. They want knowledge. They want it to be clear what happened to them and how it happened, and they want a record, which again, I think it is very much a legacy of what we saw in the Holocaust. And as I mentioned, there's a very powerful cascade effect that happens as some survivors get a little bit of victory or a little bit of movement, others around the world watch. The role of global networks is incredibly interesting and important on this. If you look at a website like the Eugenics Archives, which is really quite powerful, Looted Art, Bishop Accountability, these are tools that I think enable people around the world that experience similar things to share information, techniques, successes, failures, in a way that creates additional pressure to respond. So in terms of a few lessons, as we see this growing category of cases and that draw on legal principles to press their importance, I think it's important to note that although law and legal principles play an important role, they do so in a very distinctive way. And one of the things that I think we should notice is that it's almost always a mistake to approach these cases as though they were ordinary private law cases. And you can see kind of the disasters in some ways that follow when defendants, and especially defendants' counsel, do this. Let me give you a couple of examples. These cases are incredibly hard to defend. I mentioned the Catholic Church example. There are many, many examples when you look at this litigation of what not to do in court. The Catholic Church cases are a very good example of this. In one case that springs to mind, where it's a terrible case, a young boy had committed suicide after being sexually abused by a priest, and the priest had been passed on from diocese to diocese by bishops. The bishop of that diocese went into court and argued that they should be immune because they were a charitable institution devoted to doing good. And the court described charitable immunity as a discreditable doctrine. The state legislature decided to abolish charitable immunity. And that's just one example of many where defendants rely on, you know, procedural technical arguments that may appear like they're good arguments elsewhere, but in cases like these, they actually often kind of do exactly the opposite of what defendants hope for. Another example, in some of the residential schools cases, the early residential schools cases, the federal government in particular, but also the churches that were involved, argued that although children had been forcibly taken from their families, punished for speaking their languages and for their spirituality, the federal government said, well, that was all legal at the time. That was, you know, there were laws that authorized those things. And even though the results were disastrous, it was legal. Courts balked at that justification. Thousands of cases, tens of thousands of cases poured in, claiming loss of family, loss of culture, loss of language, and as I mentioned, the eventual settlement cost the government nearly $6 billion and created a truth commission. Of course, that's not due only to the kinds of arguments that they made, but I think the fact that they were so tone deaf about making that kind of argument spurred so many more people to come forward and spurred lawyers to push and advocates to push in a different way. Similarly, in the Harvard photograph case, commentators have wondered if Harvard will defend itself against the argument that there was no consent given by the slave by pointing to the fact that at the time that photograph was taken, those photographs, slaves were legally considered to be property and hence incapable of consent, hence no requirement of consent applied. And so you can see the way that these kinds of cases engage defendants in the kinds of arguments that those of us in countries like Canada think tend to be evil law arguments that are, you know, quite far away from how we understand ourselves and our own pasts. And so those are some of the challenges I think that characterize these cases. There are also many other elements. I think I'm probably getting a little bit short on time, so yeah, I'll mention one other thing that I think is really interesting. The symbolic element of compensation is also critically important in these cases. So sometimes defendants will settle these cases, but with institutional liability, often you have a situation where there are multiple defendants. If compensation does not come from the most culpable defendant, actually in some cases plaintiffs will reject compensation entirely. A good example is with the Comfort Women, a lot of activity on this recently. The Japanese government refused to pay compensation in that case, and a compensation did come from some organizations and businesses and others, but some of the survivors refused to accept compensation because they felt it was very important that it actually come from the right people. Similarly, in the residential schools context, some survivors have pointed to the fact that the Catholic Church, which ran most of the schools and was considered the most culpable defendant, has been the most reluctant to give compensation. And then survivors feel, I'm not sure I want compensation if it's not coming from the right defendant because of the moral significance of being wronged. Similarly, in a number of these cases, lawyers who engage in settlement do what lawyers usually do, which is that they say, this settlement is final and binding and that's it, and that's the last word on this matter and everything's done. Don't say that in a historic injustice case. In many of these cases, and again, the Comfort Women is a good example of this, in the most recent activity in Japan, the government, which had, you know, given compensation a couple of times and had also apologized a couple of times, but different people apologizing and for different things, was insisting on the fact that this was full and final and it was over. And again, that only created a sense in the survivors of hostility. And although one can understand that lawyers might want to argue that in cases like this, for the defendant to sort of press the idea that it's all over, it's final, it's done, can often completely undermine settlement in a way that is very, very different than it would be in an ordinary case. And so those are just a few thoughts about what one might take out of these cases. Just so that we have enough time, I think I'll stop there with sort of one final set of concerns, and that concerns the role of lawyers. In many of these cases, this is one of the things I feel most complicated about, because in many of these cases, the claimants are incredibly vulnerable. And the lawyer appears, as I would say, as both hero and as villain across these various stories. In cases like, I'll give the residential schools case as an example. Those cases would never have come to court if there had not been lawyers who were willing to work for years with absolutely no compensation. Many of them did not take any compensation at all in the long run. And so it was really only their dedication and sometimes like 15 years of litigation, massive litigation with very, very little to show for it. So lawyers in that way can be incredibly important, and many of these cases wouldn't survive without lawyers who are pressing them forward. At the same time, because of the vulnerability of the claimants, lawyers can also play a really disturbing role as well. Again, in the residential schools case, there's a lawyer, I would say he's infamous in Canada. His name, for good or for ill, is Tony Merchant. He, during the residential schools activity, he actually went out to Indigenous communities that had not spoken about residential schools. Many of the survivors had never told anyone what had happened to them. And he went to communities, knocked on people's doors, signed people up, promised them massive amounts of money, that it wouldn't be any problem, it would be really simple. He signed up tens of thousands of survivors. He got $40 million in the settlement itself. That is currently being litigated. He also helped to devise a system, the one I helped to oversee, that is incredibly complex, that requires a lot of lawyers, and in that system, he and his firm have made a massive, massive amount of money. And yet, without lawyers, survivors do not do well. In the examples where there are systems put in place and there's no availability to get legal counsel, this happened in some of the eugenics cases, the rate of participation of survivors is much lower. They don't show up. They don't get awards that are nearly as reflective of their damages. And so one of the things that I feel kind of most complicated about as a lawyer and a former law dean is how to understand that role of lawyers, and whether there are ways as we look forward that it might be possible to get some of the benefits of having lawyers, and they're critical. This would never, many of these situations would never have been brought to light at all if it wasn't for lawyers. But are there ways to harness some of the power of law without so many of the downsides that these cases reveal, and certainly the restitution case do as well? So I hope this has been of some assistance. There is a lot more to say, and I look forward to your comment and also to any questions.